Well, good morning, MPC, and good morning to all you visitors who are dropping in on our online service. I hope you're going to have a wonderful time today around God's Word and our brief time of worship. Glad that you can be part of this experience. As you can tell, I'm filming this not at Empire Street, but actually I'm filming this in a nice country home on my holiday. It's in the northeast of Scotland. But hey, we're here and we're here to worship God together. Today I did something really interesting. I visited a large ship, a large fishing boat in Fraserburgh, and the boat was called the Grateful. And it's not like your average fishing boat. It's, you know, when we think of fishing boats, we think of small vessels, but this is almost like a huge boat. A massive vessel, almost like a fish factory out in the open sea. And I had a bit of a tour around. I saw all the various different compartments where the fish was stored. It can store up to 2,000 tons of fish. I thought that's pretty amazing. And it goes out in the ocean and it catches the fish that it needs before it goes back to port to offload the fish. Quite an amazing tour that I had around this boat today. And as I was looking at this, I was thinking of the story of Noah and the ark, and I'm reminded of what the writer of Hebrews says in Hebrews chapter 11. The writer of Hebrews says this, that by faith, Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear, built an ark to save his family. By his faith, he condemned the world and, it says, became an heir of righteousness that is in keeping with faith. You know, Noah demonstrated his faith by doing something big for God. Yeah, he built an ark. In the story in Genesis, the ark was pretty impressive, pretty big. But the thing that really just struck me about Noah was that it was an act of obedience, that his faith act in God was an act of trust and obedience to God, particularly in a culture, in a world that people would have probably mocked and ridiculed him doing what he was called to do. And sometimes when we take a step of faith, when we trust God, sometimes it's not so much faith in the big things like building an ark, but it's actually the faith in the little things, in actually just being obedient to God in those little aspects, those little issues of our life. Sometimes I believe that's the biggest step of faith that we can take, in the little things of obedience to the Lord. I want to encourage you this morning. In a moment, I'm going to hand over to Kate and then Ken Calder. He's going to bring God's word to us. But I want to encourage you that as we think about this importance of living a life of faith, that we live a life of obedience in the small things. Hey, I'm going to go open in prayer, and then I'm going to hand over in a moment to Kate, who's going to bring our kids' slot. Father, we just thank you for this time that we have today, Lord, just to come in your presence, to be able to worship you, to be able to learn from your word. I pray that, Lord, that you'll just give us ears to hear, Lord. Help us to live a life of faith. Yes, faith to believe in you for the big things, but also faith to trust in you and obey you in the little things. Lord, we just commit this time into your hands. And I just pray that, Lord, that you'll give us ears to hear what it is that you want to say to us through your word and our time of worship, in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, I'm going to hand over to Kate now, and she is going to bring our kids' slot. See you in a moment. Bye.
Hi, I just want to say hi to all the children again this morning. Thank you for joining us. Now, this week, I want to ask you a question. Have you ever made anyone jump or surprised anyone? Or has anybody ever made you jump? I love watching those funny YouTube videos where someone is hiding behind a door and somebody tries to jump out on them and it makes them scream or it makes them do something funny. I think that they are hilarious. And maybe you've done this to somebody, or maybe somebody's done this to you. But I wanted to tell you a really funny story about one time where I scared my sister. This was a while ago now. Now, the one thing you have to know about my sister is that she is really, really, really scared of spiders. I mean, I am scared of spiders, but nowhere near as scared as my sister is of spiders. And I don't mean a little bit scared, but she is a lot scared. She can't even watch them on the telly. So we have this toy spider that the girls love to play with. And one day my sister was at my house and she got up and took something away to the kitchen, took a cup of tea away. And while she was out of the room, we put this huge toy spider on her, right next to her chair. And when she got back, she didn't see it straight away. So she came and she sat down, and then after a little while, she looked to the right of her and she spotted it. And you have never heard a scream like it. She screamed so loud, jumped up and ran out of the room, which was not very nice for my sister, but it was really funny. And things like that can be really funny. But there are some surprises that aren't funny. At the moment, when we turn on the TV and the news comes on, sometimes it seems like there is something bad that is happening all the time. Something that no one expected or saw coming. Things like diseases, things like explosions or wars. And I even saw this week that some faraway countries have had a surprise infestation of locusts, which are like big grasshopper type bugs that eat all the plants, and so they can't grow any food, so they're going really, really hungry. Now, sometimes we can get scared and worried about these bad surprises that keep happening around us, and we start wondering what's going to happen next. But I want to tell you something that's really special, and this is that nothing, no matter what, nothing surprises God. God doesn't get surprised. He'd actually be really bad at trying to scare him or making him jump, because he knows everything that has ever happened and everything that is going to happen. And he has even told us a long time ago in the Bible that things like the things that I've mentioned a minute ago are going to happen. In Luke 21, verses 10 and 11, it says, "Then Jesus said to them, 'Nations will fight against other nations. Kingdoms will fight against other kingdoms. There will be great earthquakes, sicknesses, and other bad things in many places. In some places, there will be no food for the people to eat. Terrible things that will happen, and amazing things will come from heaven to warn people.'" But although God tells us that all these terrible things are going to happen, he doesn't leave us with just the terrible things. God has a plan, and it's an amazing plan that involves me, and it involves you, and it involves everybody on the earth and everyone who believes in him. And that plan is to defeat every sickness and every war and every bad thing that could happen and that might happen once and for all. And the best part is that he has not left us out of this plan, and he wants us to be a part of it. In Jeremiah 29, verse 11, it says, "I say this because I know the plans that I have for you. This message is from the Lord. I have good plans for you. I don't plan to hurt you. I plan to give you a hope and a good future." So that means no matter what happens in the world, no matter what happens in your life, whether it's good or bad, or what we see when we turn the news on, or what happens in the world, we don't have to worry, because God has promised us that he doesn't plan to hurt us, and he is going to give us a hope and a good future. So now I'm going to hand back over to whoever it is. Bye.
Thank you, Kate, for that kids slot. And without any further ado, guys, I'm now going to hand over to Ken Calder, who is going to share to us from God's Word. See you later, guys.
Hello and welcome. Thanks for joining us. My message today may seem to remind some viewers of camping in their younger days, when the front door was a tent flap and you sat round a campfire sipping drinks from a tin mug. Because today's short message is entitled Tent Peg Typology. Now, the book of Hebrews is often seen as the key to the book of Leviticus, because Hebrews sets out to convince Jews in particular that Christ is the fulfillment of all the type and shadow laid out in Leviticus. But today, we turn our thoughts specifically to Hebrews chapter 11. Of course, we're all aware there are numerous translations of the Bible, and we all have our favourite version. But today I'm using the New King James Bible for these few thoughts. Now, in the NKJ, that first verse starts off like this. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for. So immediately we start to read this chapter, we see that our faith is not airy-fairy. True faith is described as having substance. Most of us at some point in our lives have taken a flight in an aircraft. It's when we're up in the air and things go wrong that we really appreciate the firm ground below. We may endure a harrowing journey involving bad weather or mechanical problems. And when we do finally land, passengers will show extreme emotion. They'll often kiss the tarmac lovingly, glad to be back on solid ground. But there's also another kind of flight, not in a metal fuselage, but in a mental fuselage. I'm thinking of flights of fancy taken by humans seeking to discredit the Bible and its teaching, especially how things began. On radio, television, and in print, they often peddle ideas, theories, and hypotheses that begin with something like this. We are not quite sure. We think that. It may be. We don't have all the facts. We don't have enough knowledge. But then in the same breath, they will abandon all hesitation, exude an air of certainty, and imply they now have the answer for creation and the existence of man. But so often, when firmly challenged, their flights of fancy end up in a Bermuda Triangle, and rightly so. But I repeat, Christian faith has substance. Faith is spiritual terra firma, solid, sure ground. Now here's another translation of that first verse. Faith is our title deed. Now when we think of a title deed, many of us are reminded of buying and selling homes. Someone takes out a mortgage to buy a house, and after many years the final payment is made, and beside electronic registration, the delighted owner may be handed the hard copy of the deed to the property. The hard copy of a deed can often be a stylish parchment with embossed wording, passed down the years from the time the building was first erected. The title deed reminds me of Abraham. He was said to be God's first missionary. We often surmise that Abraham's calling from Ur of the Chaldees to Canaan was the whole deal. But actually, for Abraham, that physical journey was only shadow and type of a spiritual journey. You see, Canaan was not really the final terminus for the father of faith. It was just the halfway house. All the time he travelled, Abraham was searching. When he finally arrived in Canaan, he was still searching. Even when he arrived at Salem and met the mysterious Melchizedek, he continued searching. He was looking beyond the land of milk and honey for another country, a heavenly one. And that is precisely why Abraham lived in tents. Now, Abraham was a very rich man. He could have built or purchased any type of solid housing, but Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob all dwelt in tents. Yes, culture was indeed involved, but in verse 9 and 10, the emphasis is on principle. By faith, Abraham sojourned in the land of promise as in a foreign country, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise, for he looked for or waited for a city. Now, the juxtaposition of tent and city in verse 9 and 10 is deliberate. The contrast stares us in the face. It's tent pegs versus foundations. Tents indicate a transient, short-term stay. Here today, gone tomorrow. Buildings imply a permanent and settled state. Tents indicate a wanderer constantly roaming. Buildings suggest the quest is over, the journey's done. So Abraham's El Dorado was not actually Canaan. He really regarded the Promised Land as a foreign country. partly because Canaan couldn't be possessed for some 400 years, but largely because on leaving Ur of the Chaldees to start his quest, he was clutching, as it were, the title deed to a city with foundations, the New Jerusalem, whose builder and maker is God. In fact, all the Hall of Faith heroes, consciously or unconsciously, were reaching out for citizenship of the heavenly country. Listen to verse 13 and 14. It says, "These all confess they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth, and those who say such things declare plainly that they seek a homeland." The Amplified Bible translates that word homeland as the fatherland, which for us is really most apt. So all the daring acts and amazing miracles in Hebrews 11 were but passing scenery for our Old Testament believers. The real quest was the heavenly country. Canaan was most definitely a halfway house, where the spiritually discerning look beyond the earthly to the heavenly. But Abraham, along with those other illustrious saints in Hebrews 11, was destined to fall short. Why? Because the search for spiritual El Dorado could not succeed until pre-crucifixion believers joined forces with post-crucifixion believers. As the very last verse of the chapter reminds us, none of them received what had been promised, since God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. Enter the New Testament Church. My dear Christian friend, if you are a sincere born-again believer, then the title deed to a prepared place is in your hands too. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. John chapter 14. But let's return to verse 1 of Hebrews 11 and expand our thoughts further. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. You see, faith is the substratum, the solid underlying layer that hope rests on. If you like, faith is the underlay and hope is the overlay. Actually, hope is a main ingredient in man's continued existence. I would describe hope as the candle of the soul, or the oil in the lamp of our lives. But what are these things we hope for? Well, we hope for his return, the second coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. We hope for rapture. We hope for resurrection. We hope for reward. And we hope for universal judgment to truly balance the scales of justice. But if hope is all we have in our spiritual arsenal, then surely we delude ourselves. To simply hope for these things, it seems weak and limp and wishy-washy. But hold on. Ours is not the type of hope common to modern life. You know, someone says in a resigned, hangdog manner, "I hope so," when really that person's actions and demeanour proclaim the very opposite. For starters, biblical hope is not limp, it's lively. In fact, 1 Peter 1 verse 3 describes Christian hope as a living hope. We have a living hope because all our expectations are tied to an empty tomb. New Testament hope is always linked with the resurrection, the rising, the standing up again of our Saviour Jesus Christ. As long as Jesus is alive, our hope is alive too. Hallelujah. Then again, Hebrews chapter 6. Biblical hope is described in nautical terms. This hope we have is an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast. Just as an anchor is cast to the bottom of the sea to hold the ship fast in storm and tempest, so Christian hope holds our souls steady amid the waves of sin and ungodliness. When the Apostle Paul was en route to Rome in chains and he was caught in a terrible storm at sea, the sailors cast 4 anchors overboard, hoping to keep their doomed ship from dashing itself on a rocky coastline. But Paul was relying on only 1 anchor. Although he was no sailor, Paul knew his anchor of hope would hold fast, because the other end could be traced back to the centre and source of the universe. The anchor cable runs right through the heavens, through the veil, and into the Shekinah presence of God. Our anchor holds because the other end is secured at God's throne. But to continue our thoughts, faith is not only the substance of things hoped for, it's also the evidence of things unseen. Verse 27 reminds us, Moses forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured. And boy, did he endure. How could mere flesh and blood survive all the vicissitudes of life and still keep going? Moses experienced the whole gamut of ups and downs, from royalty to ruggedness, from prince to privation, from silk to suffering. Moses knew hunger and thirst, family treachery, national backsliding, terrible plagues, delayed conquest, total wipeout of a generation, and the final indignity, entry refused at the border of the promised land. It was Moses who wrote under divine inspiration that God made man in his own image. But he himself was constantly under intense pressure to make God in man's image. The fickle tribes of Israel exemplified Romans chapter 1, exchanging the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like mortal human beings and birds and animals and reptiles. You know, only a very short time after the Exodus from Egypt, the Israelites made the golden calf and worshipped it. But where idols were concerned, Moses swam against the tide. And even though all the surrounding nations served visible gods, he endured as seeing him who is invisible. I do love those words. He endured as seeing him who is invisible. In the face of wholesale idolatry and huge pressure from friends and foe alike, Moses steadfastly refused to capitulate. Doesn't that tell us something? That after the Exodus from Egypt, Moses had a real and lasting experience on Mount Sinai. How else would he hold out against the overwhelming demand to worship idols, unless he himself had an exceptional and amazing encounter with God on the Mount, hearing those words, "You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourselves any carved image or any likeness of anything that is in the heavens above or the earth beneath. You shall not bow down to them nor serve them." Unquote. So, how did faith manifest itself in the life of Moses? Remember, Moses was said to be the meekest man on earth. Yet somehow meekness doesn't sit easily with a biblical character who is uncompromising and determined to implement God's plan, whatever the cost. But while Israel journeyed those many years in the wilderness, Moses' fortitude and unyielding manner was actually evidence or proof of things unseen. That's also the case today with the new birth. If anyone is in Christ, he or she is a new creation. Old things pass away. All things become new. When saving faith comes into operation and people sincerely receive Jesus Christ, their lives change, their goals change, their purposes change. And all this change in thought and behavior is evidence of an invisible force at work. It's proof of things unseen. Okay. In this hall of faith, we have a long list of illustrious names. So let's take a quick look at who comes first in the roll of honor. Strangely, it isn't a who, but a what. Because the very first exercise in faith is belief in special creation. By faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which are visible. But why should universal creation take first place importance in the hall of faith? Because God the Holy Spirit knew that down the generations, the burning question would be how things began. Now, at this time, science is in a cleft stick. The media is voracious, clamoring for authoritative statements about the beginning of the universe and the origins of humanity. But science cannot truly provide categorical answers. There's much speculation, and those very unscientific words, chance and luck, are often used to explain what seems a bizarre twist of fate, whereby myriads of lifeless planets in our galaxy are incapable of sustaining human life. They've all been bypassed to allow man to exist on just one single tailor-made planet. Chance is not an explanation. Chance is an excuse, because there is no concrete solution for our planet's existence. The word chance, of course, conjures up thoughts of haphazard, crudity, chaos. Yet the more science investigates, the more it finds order, harmony, intrinsic divine in this amazing physical world. However we slice and dice creation theories, our wonderful planet is unexplainable, a complete conundrum. Tell me, what is the likelihood of Earth's bounty supplying all the needs of man? Simply by chance? A million to one? A billion to one? A trillion to one? No, the zeros would fall off the edge of the page before you were anywhere near probability. So, how did man come to live on an oven-ready planet? We are inevitably forced back to that vexatious Bible verse, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." And Psalm 115, verse 16 says, "The heavens are the Lord's, but the earth he has given to the children of men." And in the NIV, Isaiah 45, verse 18 says, "The Lord fashioned and made the earth. He founded it. He did not create it to be empty, but he formed it to be inhabited." In these modern times, Genesis chapter 1 is the believer's battlefield. And it's important, it's vital that we keep the faith and not be dissuaded from Bible truths. We are not to be swayed by famous personalities or by sensational announcements or by the media at large. These are not your Bible. The Word of God is your Bible. Don't be hoodwinked. Remember, gullibility is not a gift of the Holy Spirit. I repeat, gullibility is not a gift of the Holy Spirit. But we can become easily gullible when prayer is forsaken and our Bibles harbor dust. So, excuse me. Finally, let me round off my comments with a question. What did all those Hebrews 11 heroes have in common? Answer, they made God happy. Verse 6 holds the key. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. For they who come to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. In that single respect, every one of those people pleased God. Abel, Enoch, Noah, Abraham, Sarah, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, Moses, Joshua, Rahab, not to speak of Gideon, Barak, Samson, David, Samuel. They all displayed that same hallmark of faith that means so much in heaven. They were all test driving the gift of faith that eventually became available to the New Testament church. F-A-I-T-H. Spelled as an acrostic, it could mean, forsaking all, I trust him. May that be the motto and mark of our lives today. Bye for now.
Shall prevail, for we know. by side.
Well, thank you, Ken, for bringing God's word to us this morning. Really valued and appreciated what you had to say to us as a church. And what I want to do, we're gonna just break bread together now as we just take this time to reflect on the work of Christ and the cross and what he's accomplished for us. I mentioned earlier on today that I visited a big boat in the Fraserburgh Harbour area today, called The Grateful. I had a great time earlier today, and I was again reflecting upon the story of Noah and the Ark. And I just want to read a few verses of scripture on the story of Noah and the Ark. And it reads here in Genesis chapter 7, that for 40 days the flood kept coming on the earth, and as the waters increased, they lifted the Ark high above the earth. The waters rose and increased greatly on the earth. The ark floated on the surface of the water. They rose greatly on the earth, and all the high mountains under the entire heavens were covered. The waters rose and covered the mountains to a depth of more than 15 cubits. Every living thing that moved on the land perished. Birds, livestock, wild animals, and all the creatures that swarm over the earth, and all mankind. Everything on dry land that had the breath of life in its nostrils died. Every living thing on the face of the earth was wiped out. People and animals and the creatures that move along the ground and the birds were wiped from the earth. Only Noah was left and those with him in the ark. You know, that's a story really of God's judgment on the earth at that time when God destroyed the earth because of man's wickedness and man's sin and rebellion. And you know, God has judged the earth in the past because of man's sin, and God is certainly capable of doing the same thing again in the future. In fact, the scriptures reveal that a day will come when God will judge the earth again, when Jesus comes back in glory and majesty. But you know, as we looked at that story, as we read that story, we were reminded that only Noah and those who were with him were safe. Noah, of course, and his family and his sons and his sons' wives and the animals that were in the ark, only those that were with Noah in the ark were safe. And I believe that the ark is a picture for us of Jesus Christ. The ark symbolizes for us the safe place that we can find in the face of God's judgment on a world that has turned its back on him. And I want to say to you this morning that your only safe place is in Jesus Christ. Have you made him the ark of your life? Have you come to that place of putting your trust in him? You know, as I mentioned before, I was in that big boat today. It was a big fishing boat. But I have to say that when I was in that vessel, it was a vessel that actually seemed secure, very, very secure. And you know, in the same way, I believe that in Christ, by keeping your faith and trust in him, you are secure in him. You are protected in him. When the waves and the torrents and the of the world that we see around us, when the destruction that the Bible says will come upon this world, when we look at the world today, we see an incredibly insecure place. But Lord, in Christ, our Lord, we find a security. And so as we take of the bread, and if we take of the cup this morning during our time of communion, we will remind ourselves of that truth, that we find our security in him. And let's just take a few moments. If you've got your bread and your juice or your wine with you now, just grab it now, and we're just going to take a few moments just to remind ourselves of that truth, that Christ is our ark, that Christ is the person in whom we find our security. Let's just take of the bread right now. Lord, we just thank you, Lord, for the body of you that was broken for us. We thank you that you went on the cross, that you died in our place, that you gave of your life so that we can have life. Thank you, Jesus. And let's just take up the cup right now at this moment. And as we take up the cup, we remind ourselves of the blood of Jesus that has been poured out for us and the forgiveness of sins that we have in his name. Lord, we thank you for the life that we have in you. We thank you that you are our ark of salvation. We thank you that you are the person that we can come to today, put our trust and confidence in you, and know that we're secure in you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Just pray for everyone in the church right now at this time who are struggling with their health right now. I just pray your healing hand and touch upon them, Lord. Lord, for those who are weighed down by fears or worries or anxieties, I pray that you be the God of security and strength and peace in like this time. We just entrust these things to you in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. Well, I don't know if you could hear my nieces and nephews out there, or my niece and nephews out there playing out and having a bit of fun. Hey, that's good. We're okay with that. I hope you're okay with that. I'm okay with that. Hey, but I want to go through a few things. Obviously, this morning, we normally have our Zoom coffee morning after our morning service. On this Sunday, we're not going to have it just for a few practical reasons, but we will resume a Zoom coffee morning again next Sunday after our morning service. We do have a Bible study this Tuesday night. Dan Gower is going to be speaking of that. And then we're also going to have a prayer meeting as well. Jeff Williamson is going to be leading that prayer meeting. The theme on this Tuesday night for our Bible study and our prayer meeting is for the persecuted church. So I will encourage you to drop in that Bible study. Dan Gower works for Open Doors Ministry, and he will be able to share something of his story and what he's involved in. And of course, on that prayer meeting that night, we're going to be praying into the persecuted church. So please pray into that, and that'd be really good. Again, we have our online Bible study again next Sunday. Hope you can be part of that, and that'll be really good. Again, just to give you an update where things are at, we are hoping to restart a cafe or a drop-in cafe at some point, as soon as possible, as soon as we get things in place. I'll pass the details on to you in relation to that as soon as we're able. For church members, you should have received a letter last week. As you know, that's an important letter. Can I just remind you, please, to prayerfully consider the outcome of that letter and just fill in the appropriate parts and return them the reply slips back as soon as you're able to do that, and that'll be really good. Hey, listen, I hope you're having a great day and a great rest of the week. And just before I go, for those of you who know Connie Devonshire, Connie Devonshire is asking to say hello to you all. Okay, she wants to pass her love and regards to all the church members. And so that's a little welcome there from Connie Devonshire. And she's asked me a number of times to say that to the church. So I'm saying that to you all. I'm passing her love on to all you guys. Hey, listen, have a great rest of the day, great rest of the week. And I hope to see you soon. God bless you. See you soon. Bye.